Good evening and welcome to the Thursday, September 8th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton School Committee. You may notice that our backdrop is a little different this evening. It's actually state primary day in Massachusetts and in Northampton, so we're not meeting in our usual community room space. We're actually just one room over in the library. So we'll begin the meeting by asking the clerk to call the roll.
Dr. Thomas Beard?
Here.
Ms. Mollerin?
Here.
Present.
Ms. Laura Fallon?
Present.
Ms. Ann Hennessy?
Present.
Mr. Danny Meyer?
Present.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Here.
Mr. Matt Reed?
Present.
Mr. Ezra?
Present.
And Mayor
Dana? Present.
Your Honor, you have a floor.
Thank you. Next, we have the public comment period, and I wondered if there's anyone who wishes to speak in public comment. Okay, seeing none. Now I'll move on to announcements. Are there announcements from the school committee? Yes.
I do have one. Jackson Street is doing their final stage of their playground, and on the 22nd, 23rd, 24th, and 25th, they're asking for volunteers to be on teams to help put it together. So you could contact me or anyone else at Jackson Street School if you'd like to sign up for a shift.
Excellent. Any other announcements? I did have one announcement, and that was just that following the lead of this school committee, City Councilor Dennis Bidwell from Ward 2 and City Council President Bill Dwight and myself co-sponsored a resolution before the City Council urging opposition to question 2. There was a first reading on it, and there'll be a second reading vote on that next Thursday. So those of you who hear about that or want to weigh in with your counterpart on the school committee about it, feel free to do that. So anyway, thank you. Next, we have recommended actions. We have a consent agenda this evening that consists of the approval of minutes for the negotiating subcommittee August 19th, 2016, and the rules and policy subcommittee of August 19th, 2016. We also have three field trip requests: the Bridge Street fifth grade going to Nature's Classroom, Beckett, Massachusetts, November 1st through the 4th. Jackson Street fifth grade Nature's Classroom going to Beckett, Mass, same time and same date, November 1st through 4th. And then the Leeds fifth grade Nature's Classroom, Beckett, Mass, November 7th through the 10th of 2016.
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so the consent agenda is adopted. We will now move forward into the reports and recommendations. And the first is an update. This is from Karen Jarvis Vance, and she will be updating us on implementing the stocking of Narcan in the Northampton Public Schools.
Okay, did you want to say anything first? Oh, all right, so good evening. The last time I was here, I believe I was asked, maybe not the last time I was here, but one of the previous times I was here, I was asked about our district's intention to implement stock Narcan in the school district. As you may have heard, across the state, school districts are putting stock Narcan in case of an opioid overdose on school grounds. The nurses would be trained to respond with Narcan, which is an opioid agonist. It knocks the drug off at the receptor sites, particularly in the brainstem, where that causes someone to stop breathing so that someone will start breathing again. It's pretty dramatic when it's given. It works right away, and it affords opportunity to save someone's life so that hopefully they can move on and hopefully seek some treatment. At that time, I had said that we weren't at that place yet on the advice of our first responders, since we have a 5-minute or less response time to the schools, and all of our police, unlike some other communities, our police and our fire and EMTs all carry Narcan. So I didn't feel that it was necessary to take that on at that time. Since then, every school district in Hampshire and Franklin County, with the exception of us in East Hampton, have implemented stock Narcan, so I now feel that it's more of a liability not to have it than to have it. And the other thing that's going on that you may have heard a lot about is the very strong heroin and or heroin that is laced with fentanyl or is mostly fentanyl, which is a very, very potent narcotic. And it is taking officers and first responders on the street sometimes 2, 3, 4 doses of Narcan to get someone breathing again. So that's a little concerning, and I thought that having the first dose be available like that in the school district would be probably a good idea. It's very good likelihood, because we have to activate EMS before giving the Narcan, that EMS would still make it there before we actually gave the Narcan, but we did want it to be available. And it would be available to anyone in the school community, including visitors to the building, anyone that's on school grounds that we find unresponsive, that the nurse assesses to be likely to be an opioid overdose, we would be able to give it. So I've already sent to you our protocol and the standing orders, which have been signed for by our school physician. So our school physician, Diana Johansson, is in favor. Our health advisory committee voted in the spring to move ahead with implementation. And the nurses, I have already purchased it. The nurses have already been trained. So I just wanted to make you aware of it and be here to answer any questions or speak to any concerns that you might have.
Are there any questions about the, mm-hmm. Yes?
If you end up having to use that with the member of the visitors, mm-hmm. school grounds, are you protected under Good Samaritan laws just in the event that it wasn't what you thought it was or something?
We are.
In the protocol itself, the first thing that would happen is you would dial 911 anyway. Mm-hmm. So we heard from you this evening that there's a less response time, but
yes,
this would
sir.
Be in the case that we could do something in the meantime, in that first 5 minutes, that could potentially make a difference in the person's survival.
Correct.
Or ability to breathe again.
Now, the reality of a situation is when, having had this happen to me many times, when you're called to a scene, you don't necessarily have all your gear with you, because you don't often know what you're being called to unless the person on the walkie-talkie or the phone is incredibly clear, which doesn't often happen. We would have to activate our medical emergency response team in the building. Everyone on that team has a role. Somebody gets the AED. We have AMBU bags that our fire department was kind enough to donate to us, which can actually help us to breathe for the patient. And someone would have to go and get the Narcan. All those things would have to be gathered and get to the side of the person. And that's where I'm saying, often by the time we gather that and we're there with the AED or whatever, maybe we have time to put the pads on, but often by, not that we've had to do that, but the EMS is already there. So it's likely that we won't have to use this. It's my hope that we won't have to use it, but I would like to have it in case.
Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, do you have anything to add, Dr. Provost? Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Karen.
Thank you.
Next, we have a presentation from our athletic director, Kara Dupree, on the athletic department, an update.
Good evening. Thank you for inviting me to present on behalf of the Northampton High School Athletic Department. As I was preparing my remarks for this evening, two major themes emerged, and I figured that I can sort of craft this presentation around these two themes. The first is around our recent financial investments in the program and in our facilities, and the second is around our community partnerships. I can answer questions as I go, or we can wait until the end, that whatever works best for you. When I was hired as Director of Athletics in the summer of 2014, I quickly realized I was inheriting a vibrant and successful athletic program. I listened to and observed our NHS athletic and larger school communities, and then created a plan for how best to address the concerns that were shared with me, how to support and maintain the good work that was being done, and how to create new opportunities for our student athletes and our teacher coaches. One area of improvement that emerged was the financial organization of the athletic department. In response to concerns around transparency, questions like how was the money being spent and was it being fairly distributed between programs? How do we maintain and increase our programming? Is the program adequately funded, etc.? I tightened our wallets and asked the coaches to share with me only absolutely necessary requests. This allowed me the opportunity to determine our spending patterns and to identify our priorities. With the help of Superintendent Provost Candace Walzik and Principal Brian Lombardi, I built a budget for your review in March of 2015 that was truthfully my best guess based on the documents left behind for me by my predecessors and also feedback from the teacher coaches that I worked with. After this work, the school committee graciously offered additional financial support, and we greatly value that support. Again, last year, I maintained our frugal approach because the first budget was a bit of a guessing game, and I wanted to be sure we were spending smartly. We did, and because of the thoughtful work of so many people, we have a small surplus. And with that surplus, we've made investments in our facilities, in necessary gear and equipment, in uniforms for our student athletes, and in professional development for our teacher coaches. I'd like to share a few of the highlights of the investments over the last 6 to 9 months with you. We were able to purchase brand new wrestling mats for our wrestling team and also new singlets. We were able to purchase a brand new swim console with a state-of-the-art operating system, a new computer, and a wireless printer for our swim meets. We purchased girls' soccer uniforms, and we are still waiting on the delivery of those. We just recently made upgrades to our sound system in the NHS gymnasium, and we'll also do the same at the David Wright Stadium. We made upgrades to our storage space because there's so limited amount of storage space available at NHS, and we will have a new shed out at the fields to help accommodate some of those needs. We purchased new high jump mats for our indoor and outdoor track programs, as well as cross country and track and field uniforms. And in a partnership with between NHS and the Northampton Athletic Booster Club, we were able to outfit our coaches in brand new polos and shirts so that we look like one unified program as opposed to lots of small independent programs. What I'm really excited about as well is our professional development opportunities that we were able to offer our coaches this summer. We worked with the MIAA and hosted a Fundamentals of Coaching class, at which time 10 of our coaches completed the course and will continue the online piece of that later these months. And I also purchased 20 copies of the book The Energy Bus by John Gordon to be used as a department read in addition to other supplemental professional development reading that I've been sending out via email to our coaches throughout the summer. With the monies from the facilities budget and in partnership with the director of facilities, Tony Kuzniers, we were able to completely renovate our softball field, which I can't wait for the spring, jumping ahead. We resurfaced the JFK tennis courts and also the outdoor basketball court behind JFK. And we just started sanding and we will be renovating the NHS gymnasium floor and the JFK floor was just recently completed. We still have to do a few upgrades with the weight room, but none of these investments would be possible without your support, without the support of Superintendent Provost and Tony Kuzniers, Principal Lombardi, and our coaches. I thank you, and our student athletes really thank you for your support in this particular area. Does anybody have any questions about the financial piece?
I was going to ask about the maybe you said it earlier. How about the sound system in the NHS gymnasium?
It was just upgraded yesterday.
Good. Okay. I heard it earlier, but I wasn't sure if it was part of it. Just know that
posted a few pictures yesterday.
The sound on there, the sound in that gym is always really bad.
We took down the old speakers. There were actually only two, and they were these ball-shaped speakers that really were ineffective.
Yeah.
What we discovered in going through the whole process is that the bones of the sound system were actually in great shape. It was just the speakers were impossible.
Yes.
So we replaced those two circular-shaped speakers with four other speakers that were able to positioned in a way that it's sort of bouncing off of every wall.
Right. Okay.
Once the floors are finished, refinished, we'll go back in and we'll test the sound system again with people in it, because it sounds very different when it's full of student athletes than it does when it's the noise is just bouncing off the walls. So.
Excellent. Thanks.
Sure.
Just a couple of clarifying questions, perhaps.
Sure.
You talked about many of the upgrades and some of the things that you were able to do. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, they came from two different funding sources.
Yes.
And so I think it's important for the public to be aware of that, that some of them came through the capital improvements that occur every year through the mayor's office, and being able to do some of those projects like the tennis courts, for
yes.
example. And some of the other improvements that were made were from some of the reserve account that you have in the athletics that you felt were projects that were well overdue, and you were able to get to them because of this, I don't want to call it a surplus,
sure.
but because you had some money that was left over at the.
And I will also say Tony Kuzner's had money in reserves as well, or left over in his budget that he was able to put towards the softball renovation, for example. So. I think it was a really team effort in that regard. So.
And just one other comment. In speaking to some of the public and constituents, I brought this up last month when our business administrator brought it forward to us, some of the upgrades. If this continues where we continue to bring in gate receipts and we find ourselves having monies left at the end of the year, I suggested last month, and I'm going to suggest it again, that we revisit athletic fees and see if there's a way that maybe we can bring those back down a bit, because in the past, when we've had these crises, if you will, in the athletic department around funding, one of the things that we tend to do is always pass it on to the student athlete and, of course, their parents. And so if there's ever a way for us to revisit that and see if we can bring that back down, I'd be grateful for that.
Absolutely. I will say that before we decided to make these investments, I did speak with Superintendent Provost and also Candace Walczyk about whether or not we wanted to revisit the user fees now, or if we wanted to wait and just see how one more year of the budget cycle would work before making that decision. So it was the first thing we considered before taking the money and investing back into our facility.
I certainly applaud you for all your work that you've done in kind of detangling some things and creating something that's much more streamlined, and we can get a true idea of what the numbers are, and we can move forward. So thank you.
Other questions? Okay.
The second area of that I'm actually even more excited about is related to our community partnerships. Last year, we made considerable strides in maintaining these important relationships, but then we also reached out and made new partnerships with our community members. One of the actions you'll take is related to Cooley Dickinson Hospital. We've been working with Cooley Dickinson Hospital as they support our athletic programs by subsidizing the part-time athletic trainer that we have on staff. They have been doing this for upwards of 10 years, and we are proud to partner with them and to be able to support our student athletes in their health and wellness. They haven't asked for much in terms of notoriety or press in that regard, but it is really important that our community knows the work that Cooley Dickinson is doing for our students. In addition to that position, Cooley Dickinson Hospital has been supporting our programs by working directly with me to plan our seasonal sports meetings. Doctors have come to speak on topics ranging from our concussion management program and nutrition to the opioid epidemic. Specifically, the doctors have been able to offer parents techniques for talking to their doctors about appropriate dosages and prescriptions, and also alternative forms of pain management, so they can go into those conversations with as much knowledge as possible. This fall, a few weeks back, the Northwest District Attorney's Office supported our work educating families with opioid epidemic. Lori Loisel, the Education Outreach Coordinator for the DA's office, briefly spoke to our families and student athletes, and also the coaches and student athletes at Smith Vocational and Technical High School. They joined us that evening. And then also she screened a short video featuring Dr. Ruth Potee, who spoke to us last spring. That was extremely informative and generated very important conversations between our coaches, our parents, and student athletes. Karen Jarvis Vance, Ananda Lennox, and I have made valuable connections between the Northampton Prevention Coalition and the Northampton Athletic Department. Ananda Lennox organized most motivational interview training for our interested coaches this summer. We had 8 coaches attend the motivational interview training. And we are working together to offer leadership training this year to our student athletes through the organization Life of an Athlete. Karen Jarvis Vance and I worked together last fall to create the Healthy Hill Initiative, which we were later asked to present at the ESHS statewide meeting for school nurses and athletic directors. And later this month, we'll present again this at the MassTAP conference about how our programs are working together to support students and to educate student athletes about addiction and substance abuse and use. This past August, Northampton Fire Department Assistant Chief John Devine and I met to coordinate our efforts and brainstorm the most efficient access points to our athletic fields in case of an emergency. We also discussed emergency action planning that empowers our student athletes to support our safety efforts during times of crisis. And Officer Josh Wallace of the Northampton Police Department and I will work together later this fall and also in the spring to offer self-defense courses to our staff and also to our graduating seniors so that they can protect themselves as they go on to college, the workforce, et cetera. We will use the investments in the weight room and in our gymnasium to support that work. Additionally, NHS Administrative Assistant Jackie Leinert and I will create health and wellness programming for some of our faculty and staff so they can use the weight room and get fit together. We will start small with just a few classes to determine what our staff and faculty enjoy and would like to do. And we've also hired a conditioning club advisor who will oversee the weight room and gymnasium a few days a week for our students who are not part of our athletic program but would still like to be active and fit and use our facilities. An extremely important relationship that we continue to develop is the one with our booster club, the Northampton Athletic Booster Club. We have asked of them a great deal, and we've also asked a great deal of our coaches and their boosters. We believe that the transition from individual team boosters to one larger booster will enhance our collective efforts and will allow our coaches and our families to focus on coaching and supporting their student athletes and focus less on having to fundraise for banquets, etc. Since 2009, the NABC has raised over $100,000 to support NHS athletics, and last year alone, the organization donated $20,000 to our program for various upgrades and investments. Last year also, the NABC worked very hard to reorganize and shift their mission from an organization that accepts or denies grant requests to a fundraising body exclusively. They fundraise on behalf of all of our athletic programs and then donate funds for our use. There will be 2 visible changes this fall. One is that the NABC will host and run all of our concessions, so no longer will concessions be organized by individual programs. The football parents will be able to go out and watch their football game and their kids participate while another sport and their families are covering the concession stand. We had great success working with the Sugarloaf program this summer to sort of get our feet wet in this area, and also for a 4-team scrimmage last week that helped us test out the fall season as well. The second visible change will be that the teams will not have to fundraise for their season end banquets or spirit events because the NABC will donate $10 per student athlete in every program to support those season end celebrations. If a program would prefer to do a potluck and not incur costs for the banquet, they may allot that $10 to whatever they would like. It's a donation from the NABC to the individual sport. So to plug the NABC just a little bit more, the 7th annual NABC golf tournament will be held at Northampton Country Club on September 17th with 7:30 and 1:30 starts. Donations, tee sponsorships, raffle prizes are being collected now for anyone interested, and they're looking for teams of 5 to sign up. In the spring, last spring, the NABC hosted or brought back Comedy Night at the Log Cabin Banquet and Meeting House, and it was a huge success, and they hope to do that again this year, so you'll want to keep an eye out for that. And they're also looking to restructure a little bit so that they are helping our alumni with an endowment fund. So if we have alumni or people in the community who would like to make larger donations or leave something for the program, the NABC will be helping to organize all of that. They have a brand new website that has all the information you need about what's going on, and Holly Kessen has been working diligently, as well as Sarah Tanner and Sarah Williams, to really get that website up and off the ground. The second relationship that I think is really important, and I know that a few folks here would like an update, is around the Oxbow Marina Fields and our Ultimate Frisbee programs. Our relationship with the Duda family and the Oxbow Marina has become really an invaluable one. For years, our Ultimate Frisbee programs have hosted the Pioneer Valley Invitational, which is a weekend-long Ultimate Frisbee tournament that attracts over 50 teams from all over the Northeast and Canada to the Oxbow Marina Fields. This partnership was made possible in part because the Duda family maintained the fields for use by the Northampton Youth Soccer programs. When the Northampton Soccer Club decided to dissolve that partnership early last spring, the tournament was in jeopardy because there was no real need to maintain those fields any longer. We might not have been able to host that PVI if not for the tireless work of Lee Felcher and Sheldon Snodgrass, our two head coaches, and members of the school committee's Building and Needs Subcommittee, Ward 3 Representative Ryan O'Donnell, the residents of Island Road, and our parents and student athletes. In May, we hosted 45 Ultimate Frisbee teams, including teams from Pennsylvania, New Jersey, Maine, and Canada, and it was a huge success. And our boys and girls both did very well. The new partnership between NHS Ultimate and the Oxbow requires that we maintain those fields at the Oxbow and that we pay for trash removal and porta potty rentals. To accomplish these tasks and to pay for it, Lee Felcher scheduled the Ultimate Frisbee State Championship, previously held at Fort Devens the weekend following the PVI. And not only did this bring in revenues to offset the field maintenance costs, but it saved us money because our teams didn't have to travel so far for the state competition. And it brought new people to our area who explored downtown Northampton, its shops, and its restaurants. So it was a win-win for everyone. Lee organized a local pickup frisbee tournament, the USA Ultimate Sectionals, and he also developed a relationship with an under-12 soccer program in Northampton, unrelated to the Northampton Soccer Club, that did not have access to fields in the city. This summer, the Pioneer Valley Chinese Immersion School reached out to me about using the NHS fields for their blossoming athletics program, but we don't have the space to be able to accommodate that. So I referred them to Lee, and he has entered into an agreement with them to use the Oxbow fields for a fee. All of Lee's efforts have been laser focused on providing NHS Ultimate Frisbee with great training and competition facilities, in addition to being able to support their other financial needs. Each of the programs either pay a fee or they cover some sort of maintenance cost to allow the access to the space. Lee has said that he would like Northampton Public Schools or the NABC to eventually take over this responsibility, as it is quite a task for one program to mow the fields and then to create and maintain these relationships with these outside organizations. He sees these fields as an invaluable resource, as do I, for all of our student athletes. Sustainability with this relationship will only be a challenge if more people don't get involved and we don't really consider what that relationship should be in the future. So that's the second piece.
Any questions about that portion of the report? Thank you so much.
I just have one more thing. Okay. Sorry, I'm very long-winded. I figure with all of this information, it's important for you to get a glimpse as to what I hope the next few years will look like for the athletic programs at Northampton High School. And there are four important pieces that I think will help us maintain and just continuously improve the work that we're doing. The first is to develop opportunities for our student athlete leadership through an advisory team or a captain's council. And we can do this through strengthening our relationships with Northampton Prevention Coalition and also the MIAA, who offer those kind of professional opportunities for student athletes. The second is to really create a professional coaching culture at NHS. I've used the phrase teacher coach quite a few times, and that's because they are teachers before they are coaches. The work they do is combined. They can't do one without the other. And so I'd like to offer them a really strong evaluation programs so that they really feel like they're getting feedback in the work that they're doing, and also to develop a coach's handbook so that they have a resource to go to when they have questions. This will require, I think, additional resources so that I can get out and see a lot of the different events. It's very challenging when I have to be at certain events per MIA regulations but can't make it to others. But that is, I think, very important to creating that professional culture. I would like to continue reviewing our existing programs and determine the feasibility of expanding our offerings. We have kids who would love to play volleyball. And with the new floor going in starting today, we have kept the volleyball lines in place because we'd like to be able to explore that option. This fall, we unfortunately had to cancel our cheerleading program because the numbers just weren't there to justify the program. And I would like us to revisit that and see if it needs to function in a different form or how we can bring it back. And then also we have girls who are really interested in ice hockey, and there's a cooperative agreement through Long Meadow High School that I'd like to be able to explore. And then the last piece is just continually investing in our student athletes, our teacher coaches, and the facilities. So I'd like us to be thinking about the track and the fact that it needs to be resurfaced. It hasn't been resurfaced since the renovation in 1999-2000, and also considering turf on the stadium field. Now that we have a little bit of wiggle room, creating a uniform purchasing rotation plan so that everybody knows every 3 or 4 years they will get new uniforms. Also looking at replacing the scoreboard at the stadium, but doing so respectfully because it was purchased by a student, an alumni group in honor of a fallen classmate of theirs. And then the professional development opportunities, and also looking at our website and the way that we can improve our communication because it just doesn't function the way that it should. So.
No dome stadium or anything?
just turf. I'll take
okay, turf.
Turf.
Okay. Jumbotron. Okay.
Yeah, no. We don't, yeah, no. Light bulbs are good.
So, Kara, in addition to doing all this, has been working in negotiations with the school committee. I just want to thank you for all that you do. I think it's amazing to me, as someone who works within a school building, that your work takes you to athletic events, and also these partnerships that you've talked about are the only way that we're really going to have these thriving athletic programs. And I just want to thank you for making yourself present and building relationships that only benefit our student athletes.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Any other comments? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, and as mentioned, we do have a couple of gifts here on the agenda that are related to the athletic department. The first is a vote. It's a gift, Friends for Football, $2,015.25 to the NHS football team.
As part of the reorganization process with the NABC and with the smaller booster clubs, we've asked them to start to spend down those accounts that we don't have control over or access to. And one of the ways that they're doing that is by splitting brand new headsets. They're paying for half of it, and the athletic department is paying for the other half of it. And it totals just shy of $5,000. And so we split the cost there, and they're donating that for that reason.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the gift from Friends for Football in the amount of $2,515.25 to the Northam High School football team.
Second.
Okay. Any other questions about that? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the gift is accepted. Next is a gift from Cooley Dickinson Hospital up to $35,000 in athletic trainer services to NHS Athletics. Go ahead.
Our athletic trainer is technically hired by Cooley Dickinson Hospital, though we have the oversight in terms of who fills that particular position. So this is a donation per se for the services rather than the actual money, because he gets paid directly by Cooley Dickinson Hospital.
It's in kind. It's an in-kind gift.
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
And I do have a question about that.
are there advantages to that arrangement as opposed to if they were giving you $35,000 and you could hire somebody on your own?
They have gone through the whole process, the hiring process, and vetting the athletic trainer for his particular skill set. So that's one area that they have the expertise and I do not. And Karen might have that expertise, but I think that relationship is important for that reason. Also, in the case where our trainer, Gary Elson, is not able to make it to an event, they have substitute athletic trainers who will come in and work in his position. So it also offers us that opportunity as well.
If I may, I just want to echo the comment that you made earlier this evening about the importance of this partnership and it being Cooley Dickinson being kind of unsung with respect to this. I will just advise the committee and the public that this is the first time since I've been in Northampton when I've gotten comments from the community on the agenda asking what is this all about. And I've responded that, well, actually, Cooley has been doing this for as long as I've been here and possibly longer. And I do think it is an unknown contribution that they make to the Northampton Public Schools.
I will also say that they offer the same opportunity to Smith Vocational and Technical High School as well. So they have a part-time athletic trainer also.
So I'd like to make a motion to accept the gift from Cooley Dickinson Hospital for up to $35,000 in athletic trainer services to the Northampton High School athletics with gratitude.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Seconded by Ms. Hennessy. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. Thank you very much. The next item is a gift. This is from the Community Foundation of Western Mass. It's $2,000 and it's to the JFK Band. Ms. Walczyk? Yes.
This is actually a donation through the Community Foundation, but from an anonymous donor. Who asked that this donation be directed to the band program at the high school and at the middle school, excuse me, and it will be spent at the discretion of the band program.
Okay.
Motion to accept the gift from the Community Foundation of Western Massachusetts in the amount of $2,000 to JFK Band.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Meyer seconds. Any discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, that gift is again gratefully accepted. Next, we have a gift from the organization League Legends. It's two outdoor basketball backboards and installation at JFK Middle School.
Yes, this is two backboards that are going up at the middle school where we just refinished the basketball court. League Legends is a nonprofit local basketball league that actually has games and practices at Ryan Road, and they've chosen to make a donation to help us complete the renovation of the outdoor courts here at the middle school.
Okay.
I'd like to make a motion to accept the gift from League Legends for two outdoor basketball backboards and installation at JFK Middle School.
Is there a second?
Second.
Dr. Barrett seconds.
Gratitude for all the gifts of over $40,000 tonight.
Excellent. Okay, the motion's made and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the gift is accepted. Next, we turn to our report from the Rules and Policy Subcommittee, and I'll turn it over to the chair, Ms. Fallon.
This is a first reading. We won't be voting on it tonight. It is a revised buildings and grounds security policy, BCA. The primary change with the policy is to add audio equipment to the type of surveillance equipment that is used in the school, in the schools. And it's essentially an attempt to provide as much protection as possible for the students and just keeping them safe on the school buses by using not just video recordings but also audio. So the changes would be adding the first sentence, the school committee works to maintain a safe and secure environment for its students, staff, visitors, and facilities, and then adding audio to all of the examples where we have video recordings listing. So any audio or video recordings, release of any such recordings, etc. And then the last change would be to the policy. Prior, it had the superintendent reporting annually to the school committee regarding the installation of surveillance equipment. And we'd like to change that to he'll inform the school committee of any installation of surveillance equipment so that we're not waiting a full year for a report. He's informing us in a more current fashion. So as I said, it's a first reading. There is no vote, but I don't know if there are questions or discussion.
Any questions or discussion? Okay.
I can imagine how this could be useful in the ways you said, but I was wondering, have we had any incidents in the past where we would have benefited from having audio recordings on buses?
Yes. just to be clear about it, what we're trying to do is make our policy align with what has been practiced in the district for the past 15 years. So I know that there have been several times when there have been allegations that students have been subject to bullying or that they've been involved in fights on the bus. And I think the bus is a qualitatively different situation from any other place within the whole school program because it's the one place where the adult is directed not to watch the students. And so I think that the surveillance is helpful in those situations because most times when you ask the bus driver what happened, you know, they have to say, well, I was driving and I was watching the road. So I think from that perspective, it has been helpful.
I can actually give you an example of something that happened in a neighboring district where my son saw a student from another district yell out of the window of that district's bus a racial slur at a Smith College student. And when we approached that district, they claimed to be unable to track down who did that. So that's an example of how powerful, audio could be for finding people who are misbehaving.
Any other questions about this? This is a reading. It'll come back at your next meeting for a vote. And there is a memo, I believe, in your packet about it, but just more background information. So.
If I could just speak to the memo for
sure.
A second. While the Rules and Policy Subcommittee was considering this policy, I was receiving more information about the city's new installation of phones, which also includes a capability for audio surveillance. So I asked that we could get an opinion with respect to what would be an appropriate use of that. So I think at the time that we're revising this policy to address buses, we should also have a consideration of how we may revise the policy to address the capability of the new phone system. My recommendation would be that we not create a kind of police state where we're monitoring all things, but only in situations where there was a concern regarding student safety or potential crime would we activate the ability to record. This was a topic of discussion with our annual meeting with first responders and, you know, sort of the typical case where we were talking about having a recording might be helpful were the two bomb threats that we had at the high school and at JFK last year. So that might be an appropriate use of recording. I think that's for the committee to decide, but I wanted to put that out at this time because I think when we vote on the policy, we should also consider implications for the telephones as well as the buses, mm-hmm. since that's also now about to become a capability for the district.
And just to be clear, it's going to replace the intercom system, so the phone itself can serve as a two-way communication device, and it can be activated by
that's
the office if we needed to.
If
a classroom was unresponsive or something was happening, and they could activate to find out what was going on.
That's right. The phones are not set up to record by default, but
yeah.
to be able to record if someone feels that they're hearing something that may be a threat to safety or may be potential evidence of a crime, et cetera.
Yeah.
Do you know how,
I was just curious how everything is stored.
So that is an important part of the opinion you received, because the our thinking is that if an employee makes the decision to proactively record a call, that that would be a student record, which would have to be then, or it would be a public, potentially public record, although it might be exempt on, depending on what it is. But it would have to be maintained according to the record statutes. My understanding of how the system would work is that it sends an email of the audio recording to the recipient or the employee's email box, and then that recording would be warehoused like all the rest of our emails are for public records purposes.
The telephones make more sense to me. How is it, I mean, do we have video on the buses now? Right, we do. Right. So how is that being stored, and how would the audio be stored on buses? And how long do you hold on to that record?
The buses, I believe we maintain for 7 days. I don't believe that the video of the buses create the same kind of student records or public records obligations that telephone recordings would. I know that even before before the capability of audio recording, the video tapes were being just reused and re-recorded over on a weekly basis.
That's not uncommon. We have, you know, the our city parking garage is all camered, and we save the tape for a certain amount of time, and then it's, you know.
Right, and I understand that. I mean, I'm curious about it, I guess, because in the other piece of paper that we were given, which was the article, it repeatedly uses a word bullying, and one of the pieces of bullying is a repeated offense, and so it seems like saving a recording on a bus for 7 days.
But the
might not, like, you actually might need that document for longer.
Right, so the documentation of repeated offenses of bullying would come through the bullying complaint and investigation. So if a student were to be subject of bullying or alleged subject of bullying and made a complaint, that complaint becomes a record. Whether or not it's substantiated also becomes a record. So later on, if there's a second incident, the fact that the videotape no longer exists wouldn't exclude the school from being able to establish the pattern, because they would have the report of the first bullying investigation.
Dr. Barrett.
So in my experience, when you need a video from a bus, you contact the bus company and say, I want the video from this bus from this day, and then you get it, and then you have it. So what do you do with it after you've watched the video and you're done with the video? Do you save the video?
I would say that in most cases where principals have reviewed videos, it's been for the purpose of providing a either a sanction or a discussion with a student. I don't think there's any case that I'm aware of where principals hold on to the documentation once they've had that conversation.
So I just wondering, maybe that needs to be worked into the policy. I've never thought about it. I just threw it away when I did it, but I didn't think anything of it.
Right.
But I'm wondering, like, what if we should have a defined protocol of, like, what you do when you request a video. If do you keep it? Do you put it in the student record? We would get them on, like, a DVD, and so you would just, we know that you tossed it. I don't know. Our surveillance cameras, I'm not sure what schools have them, which ones do not, but I'm assuming some of our schools have those. So is there a certain amount of time you can go back and get video from the surveillance cameras?
There is. And I would suspect that it varies because we have different systems in different schools. I don't know the exact details of how far back we can go.
Yeah. So I'm just wondering if, like, we want to just have the policy be all-inclusive.
Yeah, because another question that came up was there's also a different treatment, I guess, depending on whether it becomes a police investigation. And I guess I'm wondering, with Officer Josh Wallace at the high school, like, if he were to be the one to do the video, I guess it doesn't need to become part of the student's permanent record.
Well, I would think,
because then it's a criminal investigation. But if it's a principal viewing it and sanctioning a student or disciplining a student based on that, then it does become a part of their permanent record. So once it's part of their permanent record, don't we need to maintain it?
Well, in terms of police viewing any tapes that might be created by school equipment, that's governed by our MOU. So in most cases, it would be a school employee viewing a video first and then saying, oh, I think this might be a police matter, and turning it over. But our police are not reviewing our tapes. Officer Wallace wouldn't have access to them unless a school official said, I think we need to have the police look at what just happened here.
So then it would be part of the permanent record either way, because it would always go through school officials first.
Well,
it was just a strange distinction that was drawn in the paperwork that we received.
I think it's a distinction between audio surveillance and video surveillance. In schools, we're having purely video surveillance with no audio. And I think the audio surveillance is considered a more intrusive kind of surveillance, and so it's subject to higher standards.
So on sorry.
Go ahead.
I forgot I wasn't with my family. on the legal memo that we received, on it, the end of it is the best practices for video and audio policies. And, you know, one of the bullets is explain how long any of the footage will be kept and destroyed. So it feels like that there's some suggestions that haven't been put into the policy fully. Explain how, well, notices provided, that is done because that's in the things, but explain who will have access to any footage. You know, there just seems like there's a few things that the lawyer did suggest. And I really feel like in defense of us not becoming what we're all, I know that everybody here agrees, you know, sort of watching our students in some.
I agree. And the Rules and Policy Subcommittee didn't have the benefit of this memo. This was just released today. This was in part, and also didn't consider the issue of phones because that really wasn't on the agenda at the time. But now that came up while we're also thinking about this other issue. So that's why I'm saying I think the final version may need some amendments.
Okay. Mr. Meyer.
The last sentence of the second paragraph is somewhat awkward in that it says that you view them on a random basis or when problems have been brought to the attention, which doesn't seem to allow for an investigation. I mean, is it brought to the attention seems to imply that there's some outside party. Mm-hmm. So if you had the district initiate an investigation or decide that they wanted to monitor, let's say, a certain part of the building and watch those tapes, it's neither random nor brought to the attention. So I wouldn't want that to become an issue. So mm-hmm. maybe just look at those circumstances. I don't know whether there was a legal rationale for that when it was drafted, but.
So is this something then that suggested amendments might be brought before the next meeting?
Yes.
Okay, fine. So it's not something that has to go back to committee or anything like that. Okay. Okay. Any other questions about this? Again, this will come back to the committee. This is just the first reading, no vote. So if you want to move forward then with the next item on the report,
okay.
Ms. Fallon?
So this is in response to, I think it was two meetings ago, it may have been last meeting, we had brought to you proposed changes to policy KF, the community use of school facilities. And it was sent back to subcommittee for various reasons. And we thought a lot about a better way of doing things. And I think what we are going to ask is that the committee would vote to allow the superintendent to enter into negotiations with the city regarding creating a joint use agreement for all of the facilities, because the last changes that we proposed seemed very much to be singling out parks and recreation programming and increasing fees for third-party users, the programming through them. And so we kind of thought, based upon the fact that there's already a joint use agreement between Parks and Recreation and this school department that's been very successful, that we could use that as a model, kind of as a launching point, to create a joint use agreement for all of the facilities that are taxpayer-funded for and essentially intended for educational and wellness programming for all of the students. And the superintendent and the mayor both seemed to think that that was a good direction to head. So we thought rather than dictate by policy a solution to this, that maybe we would take a much more time-consuming but hopefully a more successful approach to solving this dilemma, if you want to call it that. So I don't know if there are questions or...
So would the old policy just be as is, like it wouldn't need to be revised?
Yeah, so we would leave that policy unchanged, and this would be completely separate to address the issues that we were trying to address through policy KF instead by crafting a joint use agreement.
There's already a memorandum of agreement for the Aquatic Center and the JFK Fitness Center, so this would be just to try to broaden that and create a working document, so in our spare time.
Yeah, I understand that it's going to be more time consuming, but I think it could be a lot more successful too.
But the payoff, right, the payoff is, if I may, that sure. Since we crafted those agreements regarding the Aquatic Center and the Fitness Center, there have been no disputes or disagreements. So there may be time saved on that end.
And I'd just like to note this is sort of an irony. It seems like sometimes when these are departments of the same city, so really very close together, sometimes those are the hardest divides to bridge compared to outside vendors who have really no relationship whatsoever. And so while it's ironic, it's I think really the right approach to take to try and actually make those connections within the larger agency, meaning the city government, and make those connections better and more explicit.
Okay, so would you like to make the motion?
Sure. So I am losing it. I move to authorize the superintendent to enter into negotiations with the city regarding joint use agreements.
I'll second that.
Second, okay. And that would be a document that we would eventually come back to the school committee for, you know, approval, and the committee would review it, et cetera. So, okay. Any questions about that? It was a second. There was a second. Did we have a second?
Yes.
Okay. Mr. Moore. Okay, all those in favor of that authorization, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, excellent. Any other items to report from the committee?
No.
Okay, thank you very much.
This time.
Okay, so the next item is a budget transfer, $16,101 to create a teacher of the deaf position. And this is a vote on this item tonight.
Thank you. This would come to the committee for two reasons. One, because it's a transfer greater than $10,000. And second, because in a way it creates a position, although it's not really a new position of an employee within the district. We have a part-time employee right now who is licensed as a teacher of the deaf. We are contracting for services for teacher of the deaf. We think we can use the public funds more efficiently by insourcing that and letting the teacher who has the license for it provide the services. The cost is much less than would provide for an outside vendor, and the employee already qualifies for benefits, so there's no additional benefit cost for the city. So I would request your permission to make that transfer.
Is there any questions, or do you want to make a motion?
I'm just going to move the budget transfer in the amount of $16,101 to create the teacher of the deaf position.
Okay.
Second.
Second. Any questions about that or comments? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. The next item on the agenda is a vote to increase the circuit breaker budget. And I'll turn it to you, Ms. Walczyk.
I believe I mentioned in passing at the last meeting that this would be coming forward to you. The way the circuit breaker funding for special education works is that when you receive the money in, you can use it in that fiscal year that you receive it or for 12 months after that. And if it's not used by the school department at that point, it reverts to the general fund of the city. So the method that Northampton has used is the money that comes in 1 year, we plan on in our budget in the following year, so that we have a little, some certainty as to how much we're going to get, rather than trying to spend it the year it comes in. When we did the budget, we estimated that we would receive $700,085 in fiscal 16, and that was the appropriated budget that you approved for fiscal 17. At the end of the year, if Department of Ed has monies left, they distribute additional funds to us. So in doing that, and looking at what we had used to cover bills in the past, we have a small amount left that we can add to our fiscal 17 budget. There actually is a typo in the memo. I mentioned that there was $8,125. That should have been $8,425. The amount that I've asked you to approve as a revised budget is correct, though, at $708,510.
I make a motion to increase the circuit breaker budget as presented by Ms. Walczak.
Second.
Okay. Any questions about this? Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that budget modification is approved. Next, we'll move to the business administrator and personnel report from Ms. Walczak.
Yep, it's a short report this month. You do have our monthly expenditure report for the month through the month of August. However, because of the way that the closing of the fiscal books work, the report is of limited value. Right now, we're overlapping the two fiscal years, so there are some deficits here that once the books have been fully closed in September within the accounting system will not look as bad, so the report at the end of September will be much more meaningful to you. Then I also mentioned that Angela Roto has received notification that the district has received just short of $15,000 in E-rate funding for this year. That is not money that comes to us, that is actually money that goes to our vendors for internet access and telephone access, voice access. But it offsets our bills and leaves us that money in our budget that can later be transferred for other technology uses. And then lastly, I think I only have one gift for you at this point. It was one I actually forgot to bring to you last month. Northampton High School received a gift from Gino Roman of a refrigerator with an estimated value of $200 to be used for the Goals program at NHS.
Personnel report?
Yes, the personnel report is much longer. This is probably our busiest month of the year. We had, as of this point, the end of August, more to come, but at the end of August, we had 44 new hires. A quick summary that included one associate principal, Caitlin Champin, here at JFK Middle School. There are 22 teachers, 15 ESPs, two cafeteria, two new librarians, and two long-term subs included in those 44 appointments. That's a pretty substantial turnover for the school district. We had 13 separations, 10 of those were ESPs, and three were teachers and professional staff members. There was one retirement, Evelyn Sparko, a world language teacher at the high school who, world language teacher here at JFK who worked for us for 10 years, retired this summer. And then there were 19 promotions and transfers. Most of those had to do with the division of the preschool program from Bridge to being Bridge and Lead. So a lot of the transfers were reflected with staff that was transferred to Lead School for the preschool program.
Okay. Any questions about the personnel report? Thank you very much. We'll now turn to the superintendent report.
I feel like the personnel report was a nice segue into my report because the number I have, including new hires that aren't reflected in your report because they had a start date after September 1st, is 51 new faculty and staff, many of which who were hired in August. So this was a very busy time for us on the personnel side. I want to say that I don't know if you know, but one of the parts of my process is meeting with all of the professional staff and almost all of the non-professional staff who are hired as part of the onboarding process and getting to know them a little bit. And I have to say that I was really impressed this year by the number of professionals who came to us with extensive experience for other districts. We were able to attract several very experienced new employees for us, many with seven or more years of teaching experience in other districts. So I think that our ability to attract experienced faculty speaks to the working conditions that we're trying to create, and the teaching experience that we're trying to create specifically for our staff. I think that the students will definitely benefit from the fact that we've been able to hire so much talent away from surrounding districts. The only potential downfall is that I don't think we're going to experience the same kind of turnover savings that we've seen in previous years. So just put that on the radar screen. August was also a busy time for us enrolling new students. We had 80 new students register since August 1st. With an overall enrollment, that's approximately 100 students larger than last year's. The bulges are particularly pronounced at kindergarten and middle school. As you know, the kindergarten increase was expected. We added a kindergarten class in anticipation of that, and I think that was a wise investment. It has enabled us to maintain kindergarten class sizes, an average kindergarten class size of under 20. The largest class we have is at Leeds, where we have two classes with 21 students. The middle school enrollment, I would say, came as a little bit more of a surprise. Middle school is up 8% from last year. 28 of the students who are joining us this year at JFK are coming from private schools. Another 28 are new residents to Northampton. We've had 8 students choice into JFK, and 3 students who had previously choiced out decide to return to the middle school, and 2 return from charter schools. But even with this bulge, we've been able to maintain class sizes of 22 or less in ELA and math classes. The largest class size currently is 1 6th grade science class that has 26 students. And the biggest surprise of all came in terms of the increased enrollment in our elementary autism program, where we increased from 10 students to 20 students over the course of the summer. So I think the committee and the community will be happy to know that several of the new programs included in the FY17 budget are well launched. Our new elementary school librarians are already planning with teachers to support the research standards that cut across disciplines. The Leeds preschool is ready to open this Monday with an initial cohort of 32 students. New technology has been deployed at each of the schools, and teachers are 2/3 of the way through the initial training to implement the Global STEM program. So overall, I think it's a very positive sign for the community that Northampton has been able to attract both mid-career teachers and families with school-age children, but I think we may have to make some financial course corrections to accommodate all the new students. So I'll be meeting with my team early next week to assess the fiscal impact of all the changes and whether any adjustments need to be made, and I'll keep the community informed of any changes that may be advisable. And that's my report.
Thank you very much. Okay, we do not have any new business scheduled this evening. Future business and meeting dates, the negotiating subcommittee will meet September 15th at 3:30 p.m. in JFK room 129. Rules and policy subcommittee, September 29th, 3:15 p.m. in the superintendent's office. And then we return to our regular JFK community room location for the school committee meeting of October 13th, 2016 at 7:15 p.m. We now have a scheduled executive session in the JFK Principals Conference Room. I would ask the Vice Chair if he would make a motion to request that we move into that executive session.
I make a motion to request for an executive session in the JFK Principals Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law, open meeting for the approval of executive session minutes, June 23rd, 2016, June 28th, 2016, June 30th of 2016, and Chapter 38, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining, NACE, whereas an open session would have a detrimental effect and further details would compromise the reason for going into executive session.
Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Okay. I would now ask the clerk to call the roll and ask those wishing to move into the executive session to vote in the affirmative.
Ms.
Milburn?
Yes.
Ms.
Yes.
Ms. Laura?
Yes.
Ms. Ann?
Yes.
Mr.
Dr.
Meyer?
Aye.
Mr. Howard Moore?
Yes.
Ms.
Natalie?
Yes.
Affirmative. So I must now announce to the public that we are going to now move into an executive session because to discuss these matters would have a detrimental effect on the items being discussed. And I also would like to announce to the public that we will adjourn from executive session and not return to open session. So we will now move into executive session.